Scrapple TV.
Hello, friends. From high atop the Scrapple News Tower in downtown Philadelphia, I'm AP Ticker. And this bitter swill of depressing noise is a little something we like to call the news. We begin beyond the infinite universe, where researchers have discovered proof of the Big Bang. You're not going to understand the math, so just take my word for it. The new evidence suggests we live in a multiverse of endless variety, where all possibilities exist somewhere. This means it's a scientific fact that on some distant world, I'm dating Emma Stone.
Here's a story from A to Z. You want to get with me? You better listen carefully.
Don't get too jealous. There's a universe where you're dating Emma Stone, too.
I'm a delicate flower.
Science. Science is amazing. Just because there are countless Earths out there doesn't mean you can wreck this one. According to a recent study, extreme weather caused by global warming is driving mankind to extinction. We're all gonna starve or die of thirst or disease while our coastal cities get washed away. This is depressing. It took a goddamn meteor to wipe out the dinosaurs. That's a punk rock way to die. We're being taken out by melting ice, the soft rock of extinction events. The only thing worse than being lame is being poor.
I'm gonna cry.
So in the slums of Brazil, more than 1,000 armored police forcibly removed homeless vagrants just 74 days before the World Cup. The shanty town in question sits between Rio and the airport, making it a dangerous eyesore to rich white tourists who come to spend money on pricey sugar drinks and reasonably affordable ladyboys. In my neighborhood, if we want to get rid of someone, we do it the old-fashioned way, with technology. Introducing the Mosquito, an anti-vandal device that emits a high-pitched tone, inaudible to adults, but terribly annoying to teenagers. This newly discovered sound brainwashes ne'er-do-wells to vacate the area, give up their dreams, conform, seek a soul-crushing job with shitty benefits, and never question anything. We're kidding, of course, because nothing can motivate America's youth except the chance to commit murder and mayhem. Why, here in Philadelphia, there was a shooting outside of Chester High, a student beaten with a brick at Temple U, not to mention Bartram High's disciplinarian being KO'd by a 17-year-old kid.
What's that?
Trying to get an education in Philly is dangerous business. If the other kids don't get you, the crappy cafeteria food will. Whether you're suffering from crippling debt, police brutality, or multi-universal Armageddon, cure what ails you with a teeth-cracking cold Commonwealth cider. It's the adult beverage all the sexy people are talking about. Enjoy it legally and in staggering amounts. That's all for Scrapple News now. As always, I remain AP Ticker, adjunct professor of the School of Hard Knocks.
In the last decade, antisocial behavior such as graffiti and other forms of vandalism have become the biggest threat to private and public property, resulting in millions of dollars in damages and lost profits.
I'm gonna cry.
Someday we'll get paid for this.
Every year, mouth breathers gather in Philadelphia to witness the debauchery of the Wing Bowl. So you never have to suffer through such a lowbrow affair, N.A. Poe takes us to the meaty underbelly of the 2014 Games in this week's Panic Hour.
It's 4 o'clock in the morning. Don't ever say that we don't have a commitment to showing how disgusting this country is.
The bloody cup's a bloody king. Bloody keep it bloody clean. Bloody chief's a bloody swine.
We're up right now going to see a stadium full of people eat chicken wings with spray tan strippers and drunk assholes everywhere.
Bloody weed is bloody surf. Bloody speed is bloody surf. Bloody folks are bloody daft. Don't make me bloody laugh. Bloody hurts to look around. Everywhere in chicken sound. Bloody train is bloody late. Your bloody way, your bloody way. Bloody lost and bloody found. Stuck in fucking chicken.
What's the first thing that we heard when we walked up here?
I want to see titties. Oh,
yeah. You looking forward to Wing Bowl today?
Yeah, dude, I can't wait, dude. I'm going to see some tits. I'm going to see some girls getting beer poured on. I'm so pumped, dude. Man, it's going to be awesome.
Do you think that it's possible that reptilians are controlling our government officials?
Oh, my God, definitely. Without a doubt. Without a doubt. Are you kidding me?
Do you think that President Obama should pull our troops out of Iran?
Yes, I think we should, dude, because, like, it's not that chill over there, and it's getting real hype. Like, we can't be losing troops for nothing. Like,
especially in Iran.
Yeah.
Do you think we should bring our troops home from Iran?
Yes, I do.
Because Iran, we've been in Iran for close to 10 years now.
We've been in Iran for close to 10 years now. Right. Yes.
Bigger hero, Peyton Manning or Bradley Manning?
Bradley Manning.
Do you feel that it's possible that reptilian hybrids are controlling our government officials?
Yeah. Reptilian, yes.
7 a.m. Can I just get your analysis thus far?
It's the worst thing I've ever seen.
Bigger hero, Peyton Manning or Bradley Manning?
Peyton Manning. He's gay. And he likes to fuck little boys.
Who, Bradley Manning? I think that Bradley Manning is transgender.
Transgender? Really? Yo, but is he sexy, though? Does he look good?
Keep the bloody racket down. This is bloody chicken sound.
The most gratuitously disgusting and
absolutely horrible. The only females here have their tits out, and it's just full of white men. It's like my worst nightmare.
Not just hedonistic. I mean, it's not just about people enjoying themselves. It's about absolutely wallowing in their own filth, their filthy, filthy, filthy lives.
They're condoning whiskey at 7 o'clock in the morning. Here's Fireball. Yeah, get drunk and call a girl a slut and throw something at her and ask to see her tits because you know what? This is fucking America. Colonel, how do you feel about drone strikes in Pakistan?
I don't know, but I'm here!
Fuck Pakistan! I don't even give a fuck!
I don't want to say that if they want to do some good with the use of military force, they should drop a bomb on this motherfucker right now.
This is like Sodom and Gomorrah rolled into one. People in the pen.
Yeah. We're bringing you to the action right now where a bunch of adult men are going to eat chicken wings in a contest. Do they win anything, Poe?
No, I think they win, they get to take one of these tanned girls home.
The bloody pies are bloody old. The bloody chips are bloody gold. Bloody beer is bloody flat. The bloody flats are bloody rats. The bloody clocks are bloody wrong. Bloody days are bloody long. Bloody gets you bloody down.
Here with Mo, one of the eaters. Mo, how did it go for you this year?
I was great. It's my first time at Wing Bowl. I think it was the 11th. I was right out of 10th place. I'm pumped. Next year, I'm definitely going top 10.
Thousands and thousands of people have gotten together to eat the most wasteful food in the world, many of them to vomit it back into the very plates off of which they are eating it.
Got our winners, the one female in the entire competition, so I'm pretty happy for her.
Hey, how are you?
you know, in this whole room full of patriarchy and white males, I'm very glad that a female won.
Rabies tonight, Wing ball. Show us your tits.
Someday we'll get paid for this.
Joshua Scott Albert, creator of the food blog Staph Meal, spent 8 months in jail after making death threats to Mitt Romney. Mark Brogzik talks to Joshua about his criminal actions and regrets.
People seem to think that in the restaurant industry, it's okay to treat your employees like shit. And that's just the restaurant industry. I'm like, well, that's not okay, and that should be changed.
Welcome to Scrapple TV.
Mark Brodzik, Scrapple TV, with the most hated man in Philadelphia, Joshua Scott Albert. Joshua, good to have you here.
Thanks.
At the Scrapple TV studios.
Such a warm introduction.
So, I don't know, where do you want to start?
I was toying with the idea with a friend of mine who's a journalist. I was toying with the idea of Staph Meal, and I woke up on my birthday, August 24th, and got an email, and he had bought me the domain. The general idea was that I was going to anonymously out restaurateurs and chefs and just people in the restaurant industry who treated people like shit in an outlandish way that kind of got their attention. And then within 3 days, I think I got my first piece of press, which was kind of a shock, and then things evolved from there. I called George Perrier a racist, and I still to this day can't pronounce his name, Sholo Oliano or whatever his name is. I called him a big black dick.
But it seemed like it went too far, like it got very slanderous. Like you know, there was a threat, like you gave out Stephen Starr's address.
That was
welcoming people to burn down his house, and what's his name, Mark?
Vetri.
Vetri's like speech impediment.
I did get personal, and it was, the Mark Vetri thing started from when I worked for one of his restaurants. He was advocating against a bill in city council that was going to ban restaurant owners from taking portions of servers' credit card tips to cover the cost to run credit cards. And he was against that, which is, you know, he was stealing from his employees. And so he was outspoken about that, which in my mind makes him a bad person. So to say that I'm a bad person for making fun of him, well, he's stealing from hundreds of employees. People seem to think that in the restaurant industry, it's okay to treat your employees like shit. And that's just the restaurant industry. I'm like, well, that's not okay, and that should be changed. And yeah, I did go after Starr. He's a corporate restaurateur, and he is not doing good for Philadelphia.
But do you think, like, you know, inviting people to burn his house down is...
I put the idea out there. I didn't tell people to do it. I just said if anyone wanted to. If anyone wanted to deliver him pizza, they could have done that too.
Staph Meal started getting like a lot of momentum. Was getting a lot of attention.
Mm-hmm.
You started getting attacked by other people.
Right.
Like Philly Mag and other blogs.
When the threat of the lawsuit happened, I decided that I would just come out and say who I was. When the media started to attack me, I was like, you know what? I'm going to start attacking them, and I'm going to start calling them out for things that they were doing. I went after Joey Sweeney. I went after Mike Bertha. I think the column was racist things Philly Mag pays Mike Bertha to write. I got some attention with a post I did about Richard Negron. He is the managing city director. I made a kind of a bad joke that I actually ended up taking down about something traumatic that happened in his life.
Do you remember what that was?
He was telling blatant lies about Occupy to distort public perception. So I did a little research and found out that his daughter, when she was 6, had a disease, and she had to, I almost said she had to be put down, which is actually what happened. He had to make that call. Which is traumatic for anybody. And I actually, it's one of the very few posts I actually regret doing. I just said Richard Negron killed Abigail, which was his daughter's name, and with a picture of him and his daughter.
That's so harsh.
That was harsh, and it was gone within a few days. My personal life sort of started to go into shambles because I couldn't find work.
You were getting a lot of backlash, like where people started posting stuff about your family and your personal history. I mean, that's kind of like just getting back the same shit that you were putting out.
Right.
Like, I think it came out about your father and your mother dying. And,
yeah.
You know, was it that you did prostitution or something like that?
Well,
or
I actually never, and that's one thing I would
porn.
Like.
I don't know, I heard a lot
of I did do some porn. I never was actually an escort. I did at one point post an escort ad, but I never did escorting. I think I would be a hypocrite if I was to say that that's not fair game and that was cruel of people to do. But that information was out there, and if people want to attack me for that, that they have that right to.
I mean, how do you feel about like cyberbullying and just being a bully in general? Whether, you know, I mean, you can say you're on this side, you
right.
know, and you're for Occupy and you're for rights of restaurant, people that work in restaurants and for the workers and stuff, but there's a certain point.
If you're bullying bullies though, I rarely went after people who hadn't done anything worth being ridiculed over.
When you attack Moses Walker, like how do you know he was a bully?
I was living in Vermont, working in a bed and breakfast, and it was when he got shot. They put out a $120,000 reward for information leading to the two people who did it, which I thought was insane. And I had already made a Kill Mitt Romney page weeks ago that didn't get enough, didn't get a lot of attention. And I had done something like this similar to before, where that I said, if you go out and kill somebody and turn yourself into me, I'll turn you over to the police and give you the bulk of the reward money. I called it the Kill a Person program. Well, when this happened, I announced my Kill a Cop program, which was the same concept, and the link, and was blatant satire, and anyone who read that or was even vaguely familiar with Staph Meal knew that I did satire like that.
I didn't see it as that, you know what I mean? And
yeah.
It's easy to throw that, pull up the satire shield and say, oh, it was satire. It's very hurtful to his family.
It is hurtful, but the police, the Philadelphia Police Department does a lot of hurtful things.
One of the big things against you
yeah.
is that you're just this attention whore.
When you run a blog, or you run a film company, or you run a news agency, the idea is to get people to look at it. There's no point in doing it if no one's gonna watch it. And if I had to do sort of absurd things to get that attention so people could get the backhanded message that I was actually trying to deliver. I mean, that's the point of blogging, is to get people to read it. I think something I personally had to deal with was whether or not that attention was for me or whether or not it was for the website. And I think sometimes it may have just been because I needed the attention, which is something I've learned. I wish I had done things differently in that I put more focus on the issues that I was trying to address.
Someday we'll get paid for this.
Hello, friends. AP Ticker here with Piggy of the Week. Here's a tip. If you want to rape your own children, plead guilty. And get a slap on the wrist, make sure you live in Delaware, and make sure you're richer than God. That's been the experience of Robert H. Richards IV. An heir to the Dupont family fortune who's unemployed, owns two, count them, $2 million homes, and lives off a trust fund. Rich, or as I like to call him, Dick, pled guilty to and was convicted of raping his 3-year-old daughter.
God damn it!
He wasn't caught until she was 5.
God damn it!
And his ex-wife also accuses him of molesting their infant son.
Get out of my house!
It's a disgusting, nauseating crime. And if it was you or me, the sentence would be stiffer than a midnight visit from the guys in cell block 69.
I'ma treat you like a bitch. You gonna call my whenever I tell you.
But Dick won't serve a day in jail. In fact, he never has. While your ordinary run-of-the-mill pedophile would be awaiting trial from the confines of a jail cell,
the self-confessed, admitted rapist and child abuser didn't go to jail. In fact, he stays in luxury where he's always been.
Dick was released on his own reconnaissance, after ponying up $60,000 in bail, which is penny candy for a guy who lives in a $1.8 million mansion. But it gets better. You see, Judge Jan Jordan who is known for her tough sentences, decided that our hero will not fare well in prison, and instead commuted his 8-year sentence to probation with mandatory treatment. Prison life, in Jordan's opinion, would adversely affect the life of the 6'4", 270-pound millionaire, who is clearly too physically frail to survive among the other violent predators. Hold the phone, right? Going to prison has an adverse effect on people's lives? I thought that was the whole point. Anyway, I'm sure that the next two-bit kitty diddler who winds up in front of the Honorable Judge Jordan, never mind the next penny-ante weed dealer, will get a light sentence. I also believe in the Easter Bunny. Congratulations to you, Jan Jordan. You are our Piggy of the Week. For all the awards you seem to have earned for integrity, public service, and exemplary leadership, it's clear that in your court, money trumps justice. Meanwhile, good luck, Delaware. You're about to become vacation land for wealthy child predators everywhere. I'm AP Ticker, and money changes everything. That's money.
Someday we'll get paid for this.